Prime Time from New York continues. Once again, Diane Sawyer.
MTV, Music Television. You may think of it as the channel that rattles your china and occasionally your teeth and hypnotizes your children. But what you may want to know is that MTV is responsible for a complete revolution in the music business in this country. These days, record companies spend $50 million a year making videos. MTV chooses the ones it likes and pays the company for exclusivity. Record companies really have no way of challenging the choice and must live by it, since MTV makes the hits. As one critic says, it's as if there were just one national radio station for new songs. Judd Rose explores the company that has become a kind of absolute monarch of rock.
It's 1990, and time for all of us to face the music. Elvis is dead, the Beatles aren't getting back together, and the Stones aren't getting any younger. But don't worry, the heart of rock and roll is still beating inside a box. MTV is 9 years old. Hard to believe that when it began, the music industry was collapsing. Music videos were a novelty, and music television seemed like a foolish experiment. Today, the experiment has become an empire. Tom Freston runs it.
It really took the pop culture and rock and roll and put it on TV 24 hours a day for everybody to see it in all its splendor and ugliness. And America does watch it, and America does take heed, and it has a big impact on the pop culture.
Big? Try enormous. MTV's style, frenetic, nonverbal, and dazzlingly visual, has influenced everything from movies to TV dramas to commercials, even campaign ads.
And I'm proud to be an American.
But without a doubt, MTV's biggest impact has been on the $6.2 billion a year music industry. The network's ratings are surprisingly small, but those who do watch, mostly teenagers and young adults, buy a lot of records and tapes and CDs. And they buy the most of what they see the most. There are examples everywhere, like singer Bobby Brown, who had an album that was doing okay, several hundred thousand copies sold, and then MTV started playing his video a lot. In short order, Brown's album became a million seller. Soon, it'll surpass 6 million.
Girl, you know it's true. Oh, 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 oh.
This is Milli Vanilli, two obscure breakdancers from Germany who rock critics universally dismiss as a hair band. Long on hair, short on talent. Nevertheless, their debut album got the MTV push. Now it's on its way to sales of 7 million. Lately, MTV's also given a new lease on life to a far more respected band, the B-52s.
Big as a whale.
It was a smash hit. It was right up our alley, and we put it on and hammered it.
What do you mean hammered it?
We played 5-6 times a day with a lot of promotion behind it.
You'd be sitting there drinking a soda or whatever and you're not paying attention to MTV, and all of a sudden the B-52s come on. You're just like, wow, this is original. This is new. This is extravagant.
The videos made you go out and buy the record?
Absolutely. MTV, Love Shack, made me buy the record.
So the B-52s hit the top of the charts, and this week they're on the cover of Rolling Stone. Album sales have passed 2 million, more than their last four records combined. And the band's national tour ended last month with three sold-out nights in New York that drew everyone from baby boomers to teeny boppers.
I think the videos are really cool. They're, like, all abstract and everything.
I guess MTV has really broadened our audience, and we just get recognized now. Everywhere we go, people come up to us, and it's all from MTV. They've been watching our videos and watching our interviews, and it's really strange.
Not really so strange at all if you consider MTV's claim that over 28 million viewers tune in at least once a week. You can't buy that kind of exposure,
but you can try. Recently, two members of the heavy metal band Aerosmith dropped by MTV's offices to screen their new video and brought a big bag of cash as an incentive.
It's a joke, right?
Yes, in fact, it was just a joke. The money was fake. But silly stunts like this are a good example of the sort of overeager lobbying the record labels aim at the man who picks MTV's videos, Abby Conowich.
I hate the stunts, to tell you the truth. You don't want to see people go to the time and expense of doing something and then not respond. I don't like to feel obligated, and we can't feel obligated. Tell me what it takes to let
you go. This stunt, however, seemed to have done the job. Aerosmith's video was a lackluster affair compared to their previous efforts, but with the band sitting next to him, Abby was gushing.
I think this is perfect for right now. It really is.
Other music industry tactics are more heavy-handed. MTV has a daily request line and a show that plays the top 10 most requested videos. Some record labels have hired telemarketers to influence the voting.
They get these things called demon dialers, and they have a bunch of people who just sit in a room and press a button and they call continually requesting the same record. We're trying to figure out ways to avoid this sort of stacking of the deck on the record company's part.
But all the hype in the world doesn't guarantee a spot on MTV's playlist.
Hi, I'm Belinda Carlisle, and you're watching MTV.
Pop singer Belinda Carlisle has had several videos get heavy play on MTV in recent years, and to keep it that way, she's played ball with the network.
So here's Belinda Carlisle.
Come on, Belinda, show them why you're in rock and roll.
Despite all that, when Carlisle offered her latest video a few weeks ago, MTV passed.
Before, never, and I don't quite understand why there would be a problem now, except that trends, they change, and fashions change, and not that I think I'm out of fashion, because I'm not, I'm definitely not say that, but it's just maybe a phase that they're going through.
Al Teller runs Carlisle's record label, MCA.
And my suspicion is that we'll just be in a fairly intense dialogue back and forth over the next few weeks as the single continues to develop into a hit, and I'm confident that ultimately MTV will give Belinda's new video a major rotation on the channel.
Sorry, Al, Belinda's song has stalled at number 30 on the charts, and MTV still won't play the video.
I'd like to know how they pick. I see an awful lot of videos that I think are really terrible.
Just how do they pick? The answer lies in the mid-Manhattan office building, which is the headquarters of Music Television.
Everybody cool?
Well, of course everybody's cool. This is MTV, the Pentagon of pop, and these are its joint chiefs of staff. Once a week, they meet to decide which videos will get the MTV push or shove. On this day, they'll go through almost 50 tapes.
Mr. Cab Driver, don't like the way I look.
The meeting begins with two videos by newcomer Lenny Kravitz, husband of The Cosby Show's Lisa Bonet. The decision is to give him plenty of airtime.
We really love Lenny Kravitz because he's unique. And what we're constantly looking for is that unique artist, the one that can be the new Springsteen, the new U2, the new Bob Dylan, who may be overlooked by the rest of the media.
It's been 7 hours and 15 days.
Fuzz top Sinead O'Connor is apparently unique too. She makes the cut.
Walk away, taste the pain. Come again some other.
The Red Hot Chili Peppers are in. But Jody Watley is out.
The Jody Watley video was very soft, and we could wait on it for now. And the record labels usually understand from us that we fit different places in the food chain for every different kind of release.
English translation, get lost, Jody. Coming out of this meeting, less than 10 new tunes will join the weekly playlist of about 65 videos. MTV can pick and choose, but the record companies that make the videos can't. MTV has no viable competition. In 1984, Ted Turner tried to start his own music video channel.
Here we go, take that, MTV.
And take that, Ted Turner. MTV countered with a second music channel, VH1, and a month later bought Turner out. Then came another challenger, Hit Video USA. But MTV had already struck deals with major record companies for exclusive rights to the best videos. Hit Video founder Connie Wadlinger cried monopoly and sued for $250 million.
To say that they were trying to create a monopoly, others might say that they were just using smart business tactics.
Well, there's no question what they were using smart business tactics, but in the process of using very smart business tactics, they had dominated the industry and monopolized it to the point where no one else could compete.
Bob Pittman was MTV's first president.
Boy, I wish MTV could have been a monopoly in the music video business. I think, I'm kidding when I say that.
Well, maybe not. In fact, this confidential memo, written by Pittman in 1983, outlines a specific plan to prevent competition. The plan? Get exclusives on the videos and lock up most of the country's major cable outlets. We showed Pittman a copy of his own memo.
Well, I can't speak to that because, one, I'm not sure what that is. I'm not going to look at it now and say, oh, God, here's expert opinion. I remember whatever the year. But I think the concern always has been with MTV is how do you make it unique?
The answer, lock up the videos. Connie Wadlinger eventually settled with MTV out of court, and MTV still pays to keep major videos from appearing anywhere else.
Exclusivity is the nature of the television business. You don't see Nightline on NBC. I mean, I'm not going to have a business if I got the same stuff everybody else has.
Preston does have a business, and it's doing quite well. Last year, MTV made a tidy profit of $54 million, and its name value could be much more.
Most everyone knows the network's logo. It's become almost as popular a pop culture symbol as Coca-Cola or Mickey Mouse. So soon, the network plans to slap its symbol on everything from sneakers to sunglasses and all kinds of clothing. And there are even more ambitious plans for a chain of MTV amusement malls called Rockplexes.
And MTV's going global in a big way, broadcasting in 32 foreign countries.
Bon Jovi の曲をお届けしたいと思います。 Bon Jovi, my baby, どうぞ。
MTV speaks a language everyone understands, a language of images. Of course, what those images say is another matter. Despite years of criticism, music videos continue to rely heavily on stale cliches like
corsets and fishnets and high heels. I'm certainly not going to go that way just to get my video played on MTV.
Don't worry, Belinda. MTV says it now rejects videos that glorify drugs and booze or feature excessive violence or sex.
We're really imploring the record companies, hey, we don't want this stuff. If you want to keep making it, you're going to have a less of a chance of getting it on MTV.
Although I would have to guess that if an act is big enough, let's say the Rolling Stones, if they did something with women in negligees, leather and studs, it would get played, right, no matter what.
Yeah, and I don't want to knock women in negligees because there's always been a place for women in negligees in rock and roll. So we're not clearly out to eliminate negligees. Our job in life is to play Madonna videos, and we're about rock and roll. It's not a serious thing. It's fun.
And why not? At age 9, they're prosperous and powerful. They've shaped styles and triggered trends, and they've got the music industry dancing to their tune. At MTV, they know it's only rock and roll, but they like it.
In a moment, politicians and illegal drugs. In a climate of zero tolerance, can a public official afford to admit past use and survive? When Primetime continues.